Hello, hello, everyone. Welcome, welcome to September Testimony. God bless you. Yay. I know you're wondering why I'm holding the American flag. Our special guest is from the USA. USA. So we have American part one, and this is part two. God bless you. Now, let me know in the comment section, as usual, what country are you joining us from? Before we bring up a special guest, I want to just say hi to everybody from around the world. Where are you coming? Where are you joining us from? Please quickly put it in the comment section. What country? So I can start saying hi. So, all right, let's see. Hi to my Jamaican followers. God bless you. Hi from London, United Kingdom. God bless you. Hi from Egypt. All the way from Egypt. God bless you. Hi from Malawi. Hey, Shakanza. Oh, what a beautiful name. God bless you. Thank you for joining us today. Hi, Judy John. Hi from Turkey. Wow, I want to visit Turkey. God bless you. Man, we have a wonderful, wonderful salvation testimony for every one of us today. So please, I want you to pay attention. I want you to just basically take in her story, because when you pay attention to the things she's going to share, maybe you are going through something similar. Maybe you came out of something that, you know, didn't make much sense to you. But as you listen to this story, God will begin to speak to your life, will bless you, will open your understanding. And those that are not yet saved, you will learn one or two things from our special guest to help your journey. Thank you so much. Liberia, God bless you. Houston, Texas, God bless you. Grenada, God bless you. Dubai, beautiful Dubai, God bless you. As you all are aware, we have been doing salvation testimony months after month. Every month, the Lord has provided us with someone from, you know, a different country of the world. And our goal is to do from each and every country, you know, country of the world, because the Lord Jesus is saving people from all over. So we have had our special guests from India, from Somalia, from Vietnam, from Guinea, from Indonesia, from Cambodia, from Congo, from Panama, from US, part one. We had last month from Pakistan. This month is USA, part two. I mean, we can have more than one guest when it's needed. And next month, guess what? South Africa. South Africa is coming in next month. But today, please, let's welcome our special guest from USA, and she will tell us specifically where, which part of the USA. God bless you, Chaneda. Oh, what a wonderful name, Chaneda. God bless you. But everyone, please, when I bring her on, welcome her, make her feel special, because she's about to be vulnerable. She's about to basically iron her, is it dirty laundry out here for the sake of Jesus. So please welcome her, make her feel comfortable so she can really, really share and bless us. Thank you so much. Let's welcome Miss Catherine. Hello, Miss Catherine. God bless Hello. You. Thank you. Thank nice you so you. Much.
Thank you for having me.
God bless you. I'm so glad you took time out to share with us. Tell us, what part of the U.S. are you from?
I'm from Iowa, so that's right in the middle.
Ooh, the cold city, right?
The cold city? Corn. Yeah. We have a lot of corn here. Yeah,
yeah, but Iowa, is it a cold place somewhere, like the temperature cold. Is cold?
It gets cold in the winter, yeah.
Oh, okay.
So not all year, but in the winter, we get a lot of snow and ice. It gets
okay.
really cold.
God bless you. Thank you so much for agreeing to be part of the show. You're welcome. Let me see. Where are the welcome messages? Please welcome Miss Catherine. All right.
Thank you.
All right, Miss Catherine. Thank you so much. So I want us to just dive into it real quick, because I know some of the people, they've been waiting online. Can you please share with us a little bit, like, your background? Were you born again? Did you know Jesus while you were born? I mean, tell us a little bit about your family history, your background. Just, you know, short minute, tell us about it.
Yeah, so when I was born, my mom was a believer and my dad also went to church. So I went to church while I was growing up and my mom taught me about the Bible a lot. My mom was also getting out of a spiritually abusive situation where she was in a religious cult. And so that definitely affected a lot of her ability to be able to teach me about Jesus accurately. And we moved a lot too. So when I was in one church and then I was in another church and I was in another church and another home. So all over the place when I was a child.
Wow. You said your mom and dad were in a spiritually abusive, you know, atmosphere. Can you kind of share with us, what does that mean?
Yeah, so when they were in college, this gentleman came into the college and he said that he had a piece of land where people could come and worship God. And when they went there, they were actually being basically underneath this guy's rule or dominion. He came up with, you know, set rules for them, like they couldn't have electricity, they weren't allowed to go to all the places that they wanted to go, and he even taught them out of his own book that he wrote that he said was scriptural or inspired by God. And he would tell my mom just horrible things, like she was a bad mom, she wasn't doing things right, and she could never meet the standard that he set in place.
Wow, that is interesting. And it's important for us to kind of recognize a spiritually abusive environment, and those environments tend to be very controlling, and you know, things that are non-biblical, they just basically throw that, and if you don't obey, you know, what that leader says, then you are not a Christian, you are not born again, you could never make heaven. And a lot of the things they detect, if you actually read your Bible very well, you know, it's either they twist the word of God upside down or just something that just plain not even in the Bible. So thank you for sharing that. Now, when I mean, tell me a little bit about your life. You were in this environment, your mom and dad, they, you know, were in the spiritually abusive environment. Did you know Jesus then? I mean, what was your life like as you followed them up and down?
Yeah, so when I was 6 months old, they left that, it was a religious cult. They left that religious cult and I went to live with some strangers. So that was really disruptive to me when I was a child. But I do remember doing Bible study lessons with my mom and I would pray. I remember being 5 years old and, you know, being introduced to Jesus, but I wouldn't say that I felt his presence in my life. He, you know, obviously he was there the whole time protecting me, but I didn't have a relationship with him as a child that I can remember.
Okay. So when did things just start going a different direction for you?
When I became a teenager, I was very rebellious. My sister kind of introduced me into, well, I wasn't very popular, and that was one thing that I wanted. I wanted friends. I wanted to be loved. It's that feeling of love that we all want, that we can all get from God and Jesus alone, right? So I was seeking after that, but I was seeking it in the wrong places. So my sister kind of introduced me to, you know, smoking pot and sneaking out of the house, hanging out with a lot of boys. And so my life really started to take a turn towards doing, you know, because I did try to behave as a child. I just don't remember like talking to Jesus directly, but I definitely felt like I needed to honor my mom. I needed to, you know, follow the rules. I was very good. I used to tell on my sister, and then I switched from telling on my sister to sneaking around behind my parents' back and doing all the bad things.
Oh my goodness. So you went from a fairly, you know, good kid, and then all of a sudden you joined forces with your sister, and then you started doing, so what were some of the things you were doing once you kind of like switched to your sister kind of behavior?
Oh goodness. It's so bad. I would sneak out of the house. I would go to any and all lengths to sneak out of the house. I remember one time my dad, he knew I was sneaking out of the house, and so he slept on the couch outside of my bedroom so I couldn't. Well, I was so rebellious and just obstinate that I got up and snuck past him and went out the front door of the house while he was sleeping there on the couch, because at that time there was nobody that was going to stop me from breaking the rules and doing what I wanted to do.
Wow.
Yeah. And then, how then did I was you... drinking and smoking mm-hmm. weed and starting to, like, my friends were giving me their other medication, like Adderall, which is just a prescription drug. So I got into even worse drugs slowly over time.
Wow. Prescription drugs and stuff. So how did the whole mm-hmm. thing progress? Just go ahead and roll with this story now. I'm going to let you flow.
Yeah. Okay. So I was also struggling at this time with an eating disorder that my sister had introduced me to as well. She told me that she threw up after she ate, which is called bulimia. And so I started doing that because I saw in the magazine that, you know, all the girls look perfect. They're pretty, they're skinny. They, whatever this standard of beauty that isn't really real. And so I was struggling with being addicted to the binging and purging, the eating and then throwing up. And when I started smoking pot, it was something else that I could do instead of eating and throwing up. And also when I was smoking weed, I had a lot of friends. And so I was able to be around a lot of people. And when I was around people, I wasn't, you know, binging and purging my eating disorder. And so that it was like I was addicted to both things at the same time. And from being around the people that smoked weed, I was introduced to harder drugs and I started experimenting with them. And I can pinpoint one exact big lie that Satan used in my life. And it was, when you're in health class, they tell you that if you do these drugs, you know, you're going to die, right? Because your heart will stop or all the consequences. Well, when I tried them and I didn't die, then I blamed the health class and the people that were trying to, you know, give me the right information. I thought that they were lying to me. And so then I became even more rebellious against, you know, the people giving me the warnings for drugs, because I thought they warned me and it wasn't even true. So it just helped me to continue down doing more, even worse and worse things, and being more bold to do it without fear of the consequences.
Wow. But then what else started happening as you dive into this drug and bulimia and everything? What else was, you know, happening in your life? Because I'm sure everything was not going perfectly.
I had a lot of relationships that were ungodly. I was looking for love from men and sexual relationships too. And I eventually met my ex-husband. He smoked a lot of weed and I liked that and I wanted to be with him. And I eventually got arrested with him for selling weed. And I did go to prison for that. So I'm in prison, you know, for a year and a half for selling weed. I skipped around a little bit. Before I went to prison, I met somebody that introduced me to smoking crack cocaine.
Wow.
And also to using intravenous IV heroin.
Mm-hmm.
And so I began shooting up heroin and smoking crack cocaine. And that really sent me on a spiral. I couldn't keep a job. Mm-hmm. I couldn't keep a home. I would go and try to get clean. And I couldn't. There was no way. I would go to the hospital. They have a detoxification at the hospital that you could go to where they put you asleep, but basically for 2 weeks while your body comes off of the drugs.
Wow.
And I would go in there, get off the drugs. And then after the 2 weeks was over, they let me out. And my mind was so messed up, I was so addicted to it, that I would just immediately go and find the drugs again. And start the whole cycle over and over and over and over again.
Wow.
It probably was God's blessing that I went to prison, because it saved me from shooting up heroin at that time.
Wow. And why were you shooting it? Like, what do you get from it at that time? What were you gaining from doing all those drugs?
Yeah. So I honestly think at the time I didn't really know. I was very ignorant at that age. I didn't know what I was getting into. This older gentleman had introduced me to it. And I wanted to feel good. That was the reason. I liked the way it felt. It did feel very good. It's It makes your whole body relaxed. It gives you serotonin in your brain. And then after you do heroin for a few days, then you're actually physically addicted to it. So if you don't have it, your body is sick without it. You feel like you have the flu, and then you wind up needing it to not be sick. So what I was getting from it was that good feeling.
Wow. You know, one
But
time
with it came all the, oh, go ahead.
Yeah, one time I was at the hospital and some of the people that does this IV drug and street drug, I witnessed the nurses and the doctors taking care of them. And I remember one of the nurses, she came by me and she was so frustrated and she's like, every week we are doing this. They come in and we clean them up and clean their system, and then next week they are back again. And she was so frustrated. And I honestly didn't understand what she meant at that time until I, came across your story. And I was like, oh, what she meant is they're gonna go back out and they're gonna do it again. Because when you see them at the hospital, they look so bad, like just lifeless, so bad. So I'm wondering, like, how would you get that low? Go back out and do it again. That is crazy. But continue, share with us what else was taking happening to you. So you ended up in prison, in jail. For in, why did you end up in jail?
Yeah, I went to prison because I was selling marijuana.
Oh,
So
wow.
I was
Okay.
selling marijuana so that I could have it basically for free because I could sell it and then make up the difference because it's expensive, right? Doing drugs costs a lot of money. And so I was selling weed so that I could support my own habit, essentially. And that is what I
Wow.
got arrested for. And I did
Okay.
spend a year and a half in prison. And I wanted to
Wow.
mention too that throughout my struggle of trying to get off drugs, I going back to what you said, the frustration with that nurse, I have probably been in at least 10 different treatment centers in my
Wow.
life. So the amount of times that I went in and got out, went out, did it again, over and over.
Wow, that
Yeah.
is a
So
lot.
back to when I was in prison, what I learned in prison was about a different drug that I had always said I would never do because I saw people that were on it that had like no teeth and they would pick at their skin and they were skinny and they just like would shake all the time. You'd see them and they'd be like this. It was methamphetamine. And I always had said my whole life, I am not doing meth. I will not do meth. I have all the things I will not do meth. But when I went to prison, I met people that said, meth is cheap, meth is fun, meth lasts a long time. And a lot of them didn't have those concepts. A lot of them weren't shaking. They didn't have, they weren't skinny. They had their teeth. And so I was like, oh, okay, it doesn't have all of the consequences that, I thought it did. So I literally left prison with this idea in my head that I was gonna go find somebody that did meth and go do meth. And that's why I found my ex-husband and we went and did meth.
Leaving prison, you didn't think, oh man, I need to change and stop doing drugs. Instead, you wanted to change the type of drugs.
Yes, exactly. I thought I know cocaine, I can't do crack, I can't shoot up heroin because I can't handle it. So I'm just gonna do methamphetamine instead, and then it's gonna be all different, right? There's not gonna be the same consequences,
Wow.
which is ridiculous.
Okay, so go ahead.
But
So
I
what
had
happened?
myself convinced.
So what happened once you got out of prison?
Yeah, so when I got out of prison, I continued to do meth. I got back together with the guys with who is now my ex-husband, and we did a lot of meth together. I decided at this time that maybe if I have a child, then the child is going to save me because I'm going to have a purpose for my life, which is going to be, a child. Instead of living for myself and the parties and everything that I was doing. So we were both doing drugs, hardcore doing drugs all day and all night, and trying to get pregnant at the same time.
Wow. Continue.
Yeah. So I did. I wound up pregnant, and I couldn't stop. I couldn't stop doing drugs. I was so
addicted. So you were doing drugs while you were pregnant.
That's correct.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. I managed to, after a couple months, there was one day that I was at home and I had been getting high on meth, and I could feel the baby in my tummy like moving around, and I just felt overwhelmed with guilt and shame, and I just felt disgusting. Like, I am harming my child. I have to stop. I have to stop. And around that time, I also, I had a dream that I was falling, and I was just falling through outer space, and there was nothing to catch me. So I was just on this fast track to hell, essentially, was the dream.
Okay.
So I decided that I needed to start going to church.
Okay.
After that dream. So I called my mom, because I knew, you know, mom knows where all the churches are. And she gave me a church to go to, and I started attending, and the people there just welcomed me and were loving me. But also, I met a good mentor that I've had for a long time, and she was just very real with me. She would not let me give her any crap. You know, she would tell me things I didn't want to hear, like, you need to leave your ex-husband.
At that time you were married to him. Did you all have like an official marriage, or just went to downtown and got married? Like, was it an official marriage?
Yeah, we didn't have a wedding. Mm-hmm. We got married at the courthouse when I found out I was pregnant.
Okay. So it was
we were legally married.
Okay. Continue. So the friend advised you when you started attending the church.
Yeah, that I should, you know, get away from him and take care of my child. So I did stop doing meth when I was pregnant, but I was still smoking something else called K2, which is like a synthetic marijuana. And it's very harmful. And my water wound up breaking at 27 weeks. So my daughter was only less than 2 pounds from the ultrasound. And they told me that she had a 2% chance of not being born. So a 98% chance of being born. And if she was born, then she was going to have brain bleeding. She wouldn't be able to breathe properly. She would probably have cerebral palsy, which is like mental incapacity. And I had to stay in the hospital for 7 weeks and just wait. And I waited, and people started praying. The pastor came to see me, and she wasn't born. So she was within that 2% chance of not being born. And then they actually had to induce me, and she was born healthy. She has no issues. She's 10 years old now.
Wow.
Yeah, so God did a miracle there, because and the weird thing is, I felt peace in the hospital. I wasn't like having a lot of anxiety about her health. I was pretty calm about, you know, what was going to happen to her. Although my ex-husband was still out doing drugs, he abandoned me when I was in the hospital. He wasn't there all the time. He was still out doing meth. Yeah,
go ahead. So
that was a miracle of God.
Of course. She came out and she's normal, even though you were like doing all the drug while you were pregnant. Most of the children, they don't come out normal, you know, but thank God she came out normal. Wow. So what else happened after that?
Yeah. So after that happened, I was like, I am not doing drugs ever again. I have my child. I am done. But my ex-husband was still doing drugs, methamphetamine and stuff in the house, and lying about it and hiding it from me. And eventually, and when I would confront him about it, he became really physically abusive towards me, angry. He also was, I believe that he was with a lot of other women at the time. And so I was just kind of alone trying to work and take care of my daughter. He did help with her. But it was not a healthy relationship at all. But I was like too scared and dependent upon him to leave. So I stayed with him And eventually this led to me losing custody of my dog. I had a son too shortly after this, and I lost custody of both of them because I relapsed and started doing drugs again with him.
Wow.
And I was told that I needed to stop seeing him, and I didn't. And so this resulted in actually having my rights terminated to my older children, and my mom and my stepdad adopted them.
Wow.
So that, when that happened, that was like the end of the world for me, because I had tried so hard to stay clean. And then I made mistakes, and those mistakes were, had permanent consequences that my children were taken.
Wow. So now, so, here you, go ahead.
No.
So here you are without your children, you and your husband at that time doing drug, and they removed the children. Who did they give the children to? Your children? Who did they give them to?
Yeah, my parents actually still have custody of my older two children.
Okay, so what happened after now the children are gone? What happens next?
Yeah, I lost it. If you could imagine, like, I cared about getting clean when I had the chance of getting the kids. Now the kids are gone, and I thought my life was over. So I had had a lot of sobriety. I had a year or two during that whole situation with the kids. And when they took the kids away from me, I started shooting up meth again. I started shooting up heroin again. I just didn't care. I didn't care if I lived or died. I would cry and scream for hours on end because, you know, my heart, it was like they tore my heart out. Something I had fought so hard for was to keep my family together. Yeah,
and you were kind of using the children like a crush to kind of like help you maintain a decent life, even though you were still doing drugs in between. But now they have taken the children, and it's like there's no reason for you to, you know,
try.
All right. So now what happens next?
Yeah. So around this time, I almost died probably five times from overdoses on heroin and meth. And I was just doing everything without care. My parents had me committed to the psych ward at the hospital a couple of times as well. And I found out, I got a medication resistant staph infection. So what that is bacteria in my blood.
Yeah, MRSA, right?
And MRSA. Yep, is what it's called. And I was in so much pain, I couldn't walk. I couldn't. It was so bad. I would go and get heroin and shoot it up just so that I could be able to live with that pain. And it went into my blood. It was in my hip. And finally, my mom went to the emergency room with me because every time I had gone by myself, they accused me of just being there to try to get more drugs.
Of course.
To try to get painkillers. But I was actually in pain, you know, but being a drug addict, you don't get treated the same.
Because by the time, you know, a lot of people in that condition, they've abused the system so much that when they are encountering a real problem, then, you know, the medical workers don't no longer want to believe because the abuse of the system. Go ahead.
Exactly. That's exactly what happened. So my mom came with me and they wound up doing an MRI, and then they could see the staph infection in my hip. And they said it was in my heart and that my heart had actually started to vegetate. So to stop working, and I was on the verge of death. I could have had a heart attack basically at any moment.
Wow.
But God preserved my life. So I wound up in the hospital once again for, I believe I was there for 2 or 3 months on really powerful antibiotics to kill it. And I was hopeless at that time. My ex-husband was coming up to see me at the hospital every once in a while. Well, he was, I guess I found out later that he was living with some other woman at that time and coming up there to see me. And I wound up pregnant with my daughter.
Okay, so this is pregnancy number three.
Now.
This is pregnant.
Number three.
And it's the same husband at that time, the same person.
Yes,
same man. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So, but I didn't find out I was pregnant until I left the hospital. And mm-hmm. so imagine what I did when I left the hospital. I left the hospital and I started doing drugs again.
Oh my goodness.
I know.
Oh my. Yeah. This at this point yeah. is just kind of like senseless, but continue.
It is, yeah. And mm-hmm. while I was in there, he lit my car on fire while I was in the hospital mm-hmm. because I told him he couldn't drive it. So he was abusive. He was just continuing to be abusive to me, is my point. So when I got out, I did have a place to stay. I could sleep on the floor at my dad's house, but I had no job. I wasn't really strong enough to start working again because mm-hmm. of just having that really bad infection for so long. The only thing I knew to turn to was drugs. So I started shooting up some pills and I was smoking weed. Mm-hmm. And then I took myself to the psych ward once again, kind of with this intent to get clean or not, mm-hmm. you know, just like I'm desperate. I don't know what I'm doing with myself. And when I went to the psych ward, I found out they did a pregnancy test because they do that on every woman that goes in there. And I found out that I was pregnant with my daughter at that time.
Wow.
So that was, I was like, I am not losing another child. I will not.
Did you lose one before? Did you lose a child?
Just the custody. The...
Oh, okay. That's what you mean.
Yeah,
okay.
I don't mean death.
Okay. No, I didn't know whether you lost a pregnancy before, but now you are consigned this new child. You don't want to lose the custody and they'll give the child away to, you know, your parent or someone else. Okay. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, my parents were telling me to, like, we can't adopt another one of your kids. We already have two. That's no, we can't do three.
Right.
So it was like, now is the time that I need to actually do something to change. So this was the first time that I went to a treatment center by my own choice. And I had it in my head that I was going to complete it. Every other time there had been some kind of like, you know, I was in trouble and they wanted me to go, or I just wanted to get off the drugs for a little bit. This was the time I went and I was like committed. I am doing whatever it takes to not do drugs again.
Okay.
So I went to the treatment, and at this place you could have your children with you. So I gave birth to my daughter while I was in there. And I found out during that time that my ex-husband was having a child with somebody else at the same time. That he was
so, but at that point, was he your ex-husband? Just to clarify, at that point, was he an ex, or was he a current
husband? I had divorced him when he was physically violent to me. So he had hurt me a couple of years before that, and I had divorced him, but I was still seeing him.
Okay, so right now you are checking into a treatment center with your daughter, and then he is now with another woman, and she's pregnant for him. Continue.
Yeah, so that was it. I was done with him at that point. That was the last straw. I was not going to put up with that anymore, and so I stopped talking to him. And he found my car and he drained the oil out of it, so it blew up the engine while I was driving. So he even continued to be abusive towards me.
Okay, so what is happening in the treatment center now with you in the treatment center with your daughter?
Yeah, so I was directed to do the 12 steps. I don't know if anybody's familiar with that, but it's like the AA or NA programs. And people said that it actually worked to keep you sober ongoing. So I was like, okay, if you say this works, then I'm going to do it. So I started doing that. And what struck me the most about that was that they talk about God, right? So I'm not endorsing AA or NA completely. I think that they let you choose your own God, which isn't right. It's not the truth, right? It has a lot of errors and it winds up being kind of a man-centered religion, in my opinion. But it was a stepping stone to get me to where Jesus wanted me to be. So I started doing that 12-step program, and in it they have you admit that you're powerless over your addiction, your life is unmanageable, that you believe in God and that a power greater than yourself can restore you to sanity. So for me, that was Jesus. You can restore me to sanity because I'm acting insane. I'm doing the same things over and over. And it, you know, and it's killing me. So I started doing those 12 steps. I started reading my Bible, which was good. I was attending church, and eventually I completed the program at the treatment center. And I just felt like, okay, I feel comfortable leaving, and I'm not going to do drugs when I leave. But I did have another issue, is that I still was trying to choose my own partner instead of like letting God choose it for me. And so I started dating somebody while I was in there, and it just wasn't the person that God wanted for me, because we were being disobedient to God through that relationship. So I moved out, and then eventually he asked me to marry him, and I moved in with him. And we I just knew that I wasn't honoring God. But I didn't know how to leave that relationship either. So I stayed, and then we did start drinking together some for a couple of months, and I wound up pregnant with a fourth child with him. And it just became obvious that we were on two different paths in life. And so he did not want to keep that child. I did, obviously, it's my son, you know, of course I want to be with my son. But I just felt God was telling me that I needed to give him up for adoption. And so I did make that choice to give him up for adoption, because I was worried that he would come live with mom and live in a Christian home and then go to dad's house and then live in the world. And I didn't feel like that was a very stable environment, you know, for my son to grow up in.
Okay, so now share with us how, you know, things start turning around slowly at this point, but obviously you are still not yet a Christian. You did the program and you get to choose your own God. In that sense, you chose Jesus, and then you went through the whole program. You met a man at the program, you moved in with him, you started committing fornication, drinking heavily, you became pregnant again. He wanted you to commit abortion. You said no. You kept the baby. What happens next? And as we move to how you were eventually saved.
Yeah, so my son was given up for adoption, which obviously was very hard. And it was at that time that I went through a salvation Bible study, and somebody actually walked me through the verses where it says that you sinned against a holy God. And I saw it in a new light. It was like, oh.
Say that one more time, because your audio cut off.
That myself, I've personally sinned against a holy God, a perfect God. And that, and it just started to make sense for me. Like, God is in charge and I'm not. Like, he knows everything and I don't. And I kept trying to fix it my way and be my own God.
My question is, when did you even start to believe in God? Because originally your sister convinced you that God was not real, God doesn't even exist. At what point did you actually start believing that God is real? That you actually, because you have to believe he's real before you start believing his words. So when did that take place?
Yeah, so rewind back in time to that first time I was in prison. I started reading a lot of books about the proof for God's existence, because at that time I was hopeless. Like, I had no hope in my life at all. And I knew my mom had hope. And so I did pray to God when I was in there. If you're real, please show me. And so that was, oh gosh, that was 13 years ago now, or 15 years ago now. And so I read, I don't know if anybody's familiar with it, but like The Case for Christ, The Case for Creator.
I actually saw the movie.
Yeah, and I felt like they actually like presented a argument against evolution and for, you know, the accuracy of the Bible that was super sufficient. I actually kind of was mad that I believed the science teachers you know, because they just try to write God out of the picture, which is ludicrous.
So now after you read that book, that was that where the convincing factor is that, you know what, God is real. And then we now fast forward to you living this life, that you have a son, the son got adopted by who?
Oh, he got adopted by, so the mentor that I had briefly mentioned earlier when I first started going to church,
okay.
Her best friend is a pastor and pastor's wife.
Mm-hmm.
And so that is who wound up adopting my son. So it was one of my best friend's best friend.
Okay. So what happened?
So I still get pictures of him.
Oh, okay.
Nice. Yeah. So I got down on my knees in my bedroom and I just told God that I was sorry and to please help me to, you know, listen to his voice and do things his way, because obviously my way of doing things wasn't working. And it was like, I just saw the love of Jesus in a whole different light because of all the things that I had done in my life, all the bad things that I had done and the selfish things that he loved me so much to take them on to himself, which was like a love I never knew or thought I ever would even deserve. Or it was like from a whole new world, because the earth is not like that. God's love is so much bigger.
Okay. So what happened?
So I recognized so it wasn't like I just like automatically was all of a sudden, you know, 100% different, but I just had joy and I had hope. And I just knew that everything that had happened in my life was for a purpose and that he was going to use it. And I really just, I wanted to read the Bible all the time. And I wanted to know exactly what it said. And I was like, you saved me. Who are you? Like, I want to know who you are, because you saved me. Why would you even save me? Why would you save me? I still ask him, why would you choose to save me when I look around and I see a lost world?
Okay.
And I don't have it within myself to like feel like I'm even worthy or capable of doing anything about it. So why would you pick me?
Then what happened after that?
Yeah, so I started getting involved in the church.
Okay.
And just taking care of my daughter, teaching her about Jesus. I started teaching some lessons at a local place called Celebrate Recovery, which those have gone okay until God kind of revealed to me some of the errors there too, and just some of the stuff that didn't line up with his word. And he's kind of a hard dad sometimes. Because he shows me stuff that I don't want to see.
Wow. So now what is the situation with you and your children and the ex-husband and all that? What is going on with that right now?
Yeah, so my ex-husband currently is still in the same life. I occasionally have just noticed that he's in and out of jail and prison. Wow. I think he's in prison right now for drugs. I continue to pray for him. I think maybe God is saving his life by sending him to prison so that he won't kill himself.
Wow. And what is the situation with you right now? Are you married? Where are the children? What's going on?
I'm not married.
Okay.
Trying to patiently wait for the man that God has for me.
Okay.
Although I wish God would hurry up.
At this perfect time, though, right? At this perfect time, yes, yes.
Right. Yeah, and my children, so my parents have custody of my children still, and I am an active part of their life.
Okay, you're very active in their lives.
Yeah, wow. They actually just moved to Virginia, which is in the United States, but it's on the east side of the United States.
Right.
And so I'm trying to figure out considering moving so that I can go and be with them again. This was just about a month ago that they moved there.
Okay. So when
and I have my youngest daughter.
Go ahead. Oh, you have your youngest daughter.
I have my youngest. Yeah, my six-year-old daughter. I have her all the time. So she's been with me her whole entire life.
That's beautiful. So when exactly did you stop the drug? How long has it been? And how has things changed?
Yeah, I stopped doing drugs. It was 2016, so it's
Mm-hmm.
been 7 years, and it will be 8 years next February.
Wow,
And
great
things have
time.
changed dramatically. I don't crave them. I don't want them. I don't look for them for a source of escape or a source of peace. When I think about drugs, all I can think about is death and destruction. How it destroyed so many years of my life and took so much away from me. And I see them as a lie. You know, they put themselves up to be this like wonderful, good, fun, like feels good, do it. And then on the end of it, it's literally death. It's destruction. It destroys your life. It takes your family away. It takes your kids away. It puts you in prison. It puts you in treatment. And then it traps you into this cycle where you can never stop. So I hate them. I hate drugs.
And where did this strength come from? How did this strength come?
Yeah.
For years you tried to free yourself and you couldn't. So where did this strength come from? How did this
Yeah, it
strength
came
come?
from yeah, from God above, from Jesus. He changed me. He changed me to where it I could recognize it for what it was. So he shed
Wow.
light where there was darkness. Because I was
Great.
always trying to come up with a different excuse, you know, a different rationalization or way around it to make it so it was okay, or to make it so I could still do it, or to, you know, some way to make it fit into my life, and it just there's no place for it anymore.
Wow. Praise
Yeah.
God. That's excellent. That's excellent. So, when exactly would you say you were saved? What year did you say you would you give like an exact year? Like, this was the year
Yeah.
that I know that I was saved.
Yeah, I think I really got it in 2020.
2020.
So that was when I had my son. Right after I had my
Okay.
son, that
Okay.
was when I
What?
just realized when they walked me through that salvation, you know, book, and I was like, because there's so many things in the Bible I didn't know it said. And I didn't, it's like, or I'd read it, but like it wasn't, the Holy Spirit hadn't unlocked it yet. Because I could read it without the Holy Spirit's help, and it was like it was
You
dead. It was
can
just
read
words.
it and have no understanding. You can read it without really accepting it. You just kind of have a head knowledge, but without a heart understanding. But when the Lord just unlock your mind, all of a sudden everything makes sense, and then you begin to align your life with the Word of God. What is the your mom? Because your mom has been a Christian, you know, and been has been helping you. What does she think so far?
Yeah, I think she's happy. She's what she's been
Okay.
praying for. So she's seeing, you know, God's faithfulness. Because I'm sure through all of those years when I was doing all of these things, I can only imagine the, you know, hurt and pain and stuff that I put upon her. Not, you know, she lost her daughter. Many
We're
years.
definitely going to allow the viewers to ask questions because I'm sure they have questions. But one of the things I want to quickly clarify before they can ask their question, you said there was a point when you were beginning to kind of listen to the word of God and accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, you moved into this man that you met in the 12-point program. And you were like, oh, we're going to get married anyway. Therefore, it's okay to move in together and to, you know, start, you know, having a relationship, intimacy together. And you said the Lord convicted you. What did he convicted you on?
Yeah, he convicted me of, okay, so I'll tell you the specific verses that he pointed out to me. Someone said, well, I was walking into church one day, you should not be unequally yoked. And I heard that, and it was like God was speaking to me from across the parking lot when I heard that. And then the other verse, what does light have with darkness? What does light have to do with darkness? I don't know exactly where that is in the Bible, but they don't fit. They're complete opposites. And so I knew that, you know, I'm aligning myself with the world and darkness, the world's way of doing things.
So that's how did you, because you wrestled with it a little bit. How did you eventually come to accept the word of God and got out of that relationship?
Yeah, God just made me miserable. Like, I couldn't sleep. He literally made me miserable. I couldn't sleep.
Wow.
I couldn't function properly because I knew that I was doing things that, you know, God didn't want me to be doing, and he was going to set me on his path and not mine, whether I wanted it or not.
Wow.
Essentially, I'm very rebellious. I feel like he's had to force me to do things that I don't want to do almost my whole life.
Praise God. Let's now allow the viewers to ask questions. So this is your opportunity to ask our guest, Miss Catherine, your question. If there's something that you want her to clarify, please go ahead and ask question, and she will answer your question. Let's see in the comment. Let me bring the comment up. Go ahead and type in your question, please.
Okay.
All right. Let's go to the comment. Okay, go ahead and ask your questions. I'm waiting to see them in the comment section. Thank you so much, Miss Catherine. There's so much about your testimony that we probably didn't get into deeply because of time. And also, I understand you, because you have to kind of read. Most people, they will remember and they'll flow, but I know most of the time you have to read. Do you think, like, maybe the history, your history had anything to do with your memory, do you think? The drug history.
Are you thinking that? Oh, are you asking my drug? Because I did drugs, did it affect?
Did it affect anything?
Yes.
It did. Wow.
And I still struggle with some like post-traumatic stress, just because of moving so many times, having been physically abused by my ex-husband, things being so disruptive for so many years. And then also, you know, my brain was trained on the drugs for so many years that I'm having to like relearn just normal life. So yeah, and it has affected my memory too. I believe that 100%.
Yes, yes. And that is important for the audience to know, because some people, they think like, hey, I can do whatever I want, and then once I repent, you know, I can just, God will forgive me at any point I repent. God will forgive me and everything will be okay. And one thing they don't realize is that, no, the consequences don't go away. Just because Jesus forgave you and Jesus received you, it doesn't mean you will not have that memory damage or that traumatic, you know, just different baggages that you're probably going to deal with for the rest of your life. They are going to remain, even though the Lord forgives you. So it's best not to even go into any kind of crazy lifestyle and stuff. All right,
let's go there.
Let's see the questions. Are you asking your question? Let me see. This question says, Miss Catherine, please, how do you handle the challenges that came your way? And also, when you felt like giving up on Jesus Christ, what did you do?
Yeah. I just kept going. They taught me in that 12-step program I was in to try to live one day at a time. And so that has been one thing, just one day, one foot, one, just do the next right thing, the next right thing, the next right thing. And then eventually it's going to turn into something different than what it was before. And then also just do not give up. I just can't give up. No matter what, I just can't give up.
Don't give up. Some people will even attempt suicide and all that. It's like, don't, just keep going. Today might be really bad, but tomorrow may not be as bad as today. So just keep going. The next question says, would you remarry if you had the opportunity?
Yes, but I'll be more picky this time.
All right.
I don't just want any old guy that I find around.
What are some of the things you would look out for?
Yeah, so, I mean, number one, they have to love Jesus more than they love me.
Praise God. I think that is a secret that everybody, again, Christian, eventually will realize, that your husband or your wife better love Jesus more than they love you. Because if they don't, eventually they are also going to start, you know, doing their thing. It's Jesus that keeps us. It's the Lord that keeps everything together. And some people think is, oh no, it's all about me. No, it's not about you, because human being, we are like that. Our feelings change, our behavior change, the marriage get old, and it's Jesus that will keep that man there. Let's move to the next question. It says, next question said, okay, I am finding it hard with my Christian life. Is is that easy when you start your Christian journey? Secondly, I am finding it hard to grow spiritually, and I do see some growing rapidly. Can you please tell me more about this? Because I do feel hated and not wanted in his kingdom. These are my questions. I don't know if I understand the question, but if you
can say so, I can say some stuff. Well, I definitely think that if you feel hated and not wanted in his kingdom, that that's just an attack from the enemy trying to keep you from Christian fellowship and from relying on Jesus. I also think that sometimes we will grow really fast, and then other days it's like, what are you doing, God? could you speed it up a little bit? Especially, you know, for myself, being like a drug addict, everything was right now instant pleasure. And so it's been hard to sit back and like just wait for God to do something.
Okay. But
we're not responsible for our own spiritual growth. God is.
That's true.
You know, I mean, we're responsible to a point.
We are responsible to yield, to be yielded to him so that he can do the work in us. The next one, he says, what happened to your sister? Is she saved now? Your older sister, the one that kind of like brought you in.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So she didn't face a lot of the consequences I did. She never became like a full-blown drug addict. She never did like the meth, the heroin, the crack. She never had like an eating disorder. She did struggle with some alcohol from time to time. Mm-hmm. But she is not a believer. Mm-hmm. My family split. So my mom is a believer, and now my dad is like not, and is mad at God, I can tell. And so she kind of has gone to his side, and I've kind of gone to my mom's side.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So prayers will continue.
Pray.
That's true. Then the next question says, please, how does God speak to you? Also, how did I hear from God personally, or how can I hear from God personally? So how did God speak to you?
Yeah, he spoke to me mostly through his word, I would say. But there's been a couple times where I've just known that he's there with me. I'm pretty sure he told me one time that I needed to be there for the low and the brokenhearted. So I've always felt drawn to people that were kind of like outcasts or rejected.
Does he speak to you through like a drop in your spirit, an audio, or as you are reading the Bible? How does this communication come through?
Yeah, mostly it's him bringing the attention of scripture that I've read to my head at the right time. Sometimes he's just given me like kind of an intuition about what to do in certain situations. But it's not like he just puts words in my head all the time, tells me to do this or that.
Okay. Then somebody say, how has life been since you have been saved? How has life been?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's definitely had a lot of good, right? I have my children. Mm-hmm. I have my family. I've gained a lot of trust. I've been able to hold a job, which I never was able to do that before. So it has, you know, and then the consequences are less. I still have to live with the consequences from my past, right? So I have a criminal record that I have to constantly explain, you know, for jobs or that kind of thing. And I've also had some other just persecution. There was a time when I was just really on fire for Jesus and telling everybody all the time, and I lost friends. I had people at a somewhere that I used to work that kind of didn't treat me very well because of it. So it has been good and bad, but that's what we were promised, right? We weren't promised that it would be completely easy. We're actually promised that we have to die to ourselves and, you know, face some persecution if we're to stand in the next life and in the end. So it's been a little scary too, because I stand for something now, like that the world in general rejects and hates and is opposite.
That's true. You'll find out real quick when you become a Christian that the Bible is completely right. When the Bible said that, hey, the world, you are not of the world loves its own. it's gonna be strange sometime. You're gonna find it difficult. Like, man, people used to love me. Everybody used to love me. What happened? Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the Lord will remind you, I told you the world will love its own. You are no longer of the world, so they will not love you the way they used to love you before. The next question says, do you have any advice on those that are just starting their spiritual journey? I mean, how should they resist the temptation of going back to old habits?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say the spiritual disciplines, prayer, reading the Bible, and then also being in community with a good, solid, you know, believers, and having people that will hold you accountable, just like the Bible says, you know, if a brother sins, restore him gently. Having those people in your life that, if they catch you slipping, are willing to actually get real with you and say something. That has helped me a lot, that mentor, to call me back into doing the right thing when I have, you know, had ideas to go the wrong way. Having that accountability, someone that really loves you enough, loved me enough to tell me the truth when I didn't want to hear it.
It's good to be surrounded by true Christian. Go ahead, continue there.
Mm-hmm. Well, eventually, you know, we'll get stronger to resist, and then those old things that used to catch us will become like, I can't believe I used to fall into that temptation.
That's true.
That's how it's been for me anyway.
That's true. Praise God. All right. The next one is, how can I help someone who is abusing drugs and refuse to change? How can I help the person? Mm-hmm. That's the next
question. I would
say
all you can do is pray for them.
Hmm.
All you can do is pray, because if they're refusing to change, you can't make them. Mm. Only God can make them. So I would say pray. True. Pray for them.
That's true.
And then there if they ever, you know, say, I'm always here for you, right? But I'm not going to endorse what you're doing.
Hmm.
And because you can even set consequences or boundaries too, healthy boundaries. You know, if you keep doing drugs, that I'm not going to hang out with you. And then that's a good consequence or a good boundary.
Wow. All right. That is excellent. Any more questions? I'm sure I've missed some, because they kind of scroll by so fast. So if you haven't, if I have not showcased your question, go ahead and type it in the comment section, and then very soon we're going to announce the winners of the on the comment, and then Miss Catherine is going to pray, and then we're going to, you know, come to a close for this September testimony. Thank you so much. I know I've seen comments that we have a network issue here and there, but God will help us. Hopefully it's not from our end. All right. Please, how can I encounter Jesus? That's the question that just came in.
Mm-hmm. Ask him.
Hmm.
He said, if you seek him, you'll find him.
Hmm.
Just keep asking.
Keep asking, keep praying, keep asking him to come in, open your heart to him. Some people think they have to be perfect, they have to clean up their life, they have to do everything right in order to encounter Jesus. No, just admit you are a sinner, recognize that you need him and that he has paid the price for your sin, and then just keep inviting him to come and save you. You don't have the strength to clean up your life. He's the one that's going to do it. So keep asking, keep praying, and keep seeking. And one day, man, if I tell you how many times I was in church, and whenever they would say, who want to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, and I would raise my hand. I did it so many times. At the point, I'm like, this is not working, because I go back to the same sin. I go back to the same bad things. And I was like, man, how many times? Every church, I'll be in different country, they'll do like an altar call. Here I go again. But eventually, it happened. You know what I mean? Look at me today. Praise God. All right.
Persistence.
So, yes, yes. Who else? Let me see. How can I yield to the Holy Spirit? That is the next question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it's where you become willing to give up things that you want and instead do what God wants you to do.
Right.
And that's the hard part, is where we have to give up stuff that we want to do and do what he wants instead. And that's our yielding to the Holy Spirit.
I see.
You know, because our flesh wants to like get revenge. Our flesh wants to be angry. Our flesh wants to be selfish or covet, you know. And yielding to God's Spirit is like, okay, God, I'm in this specific situation right now. I'm going to choose not to, whatever it is, show me how to do it your way instead.
So the next one, he says, have you published your life story? If so, how do I get such material?
I do have the testimony video posted on YouTube, but I haven't written it. I have thought about writing a book, but I have not had the time
to do,
to do that. So okay. Maybe someday.
Okay. Next question. What is salvation?
Yeah, salvation is when God opens up your eyes. You put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ for your eternal soul and for your life. You recognize him as God. You recognize him as the creator. You recognize him as who he says he was, and believing it and trusting it, and then doing your best to live your life in alignment with what he says.
Hmm.
And he gives you the Holy Spirit to help you do it.
Yes, yes, yes. Does salvation make one perfect?
No. We still sin. Unfortunately, we won't be perfect until we get our new glorified bodies.
It's important, and I love these questions because there are some people that actually believe they are perfect, and even in this side of eternity. And when you basically say, no, not really, it's something God has to continue to work on you until you cross over and leave this flesh, it almost seems like they think you are encouraging sin. You know, some people, they don't have the reality of what the Christian life is. And when you're like, no, this is the reality, to them, it's like you're encouraging sin. It's like, no, we're not encouraging sin. We're just trying to like be honest and be clear that, hey, this is something you're going to battle with for the rest of your life. But the difference is that before, sin rule over you. Like, you know, in your situation, you wanted to stop the drug and no matter what, you couldn't. But Jesus has empowered you that even if you are really low tomorrow and the option to do drug comes to mind, Jesus has given you the power to say no. Before, you didn't have that power. Exactly. Yeah, so that is the difference now. So sin will still try to come. Sometimes you're going to fall. And, you know, but the power is there to rise up and keep on moving and love the Lord. Who is Jesus to you, Miss Catherine? Who is Jesus to you?
Oh gosh, he's this person that was there with me, and he still is there with me, and he made me, and he knows me completely, so he knows what I need, and he knows what's best for me, and I just can't wait to see his face.
Praise
God. I just want to know him more.
So is Jesus God? Because a lot of people say Jesus is not God. Is Jesus God?
Yeah, he's God. He's the image of the invisible God. So he's everything that God is, but he actually came. He loved us so much he came into our mess and offered a way out of it and a permanent solution to our rebellion.
All right.
Which to me is amazing.
I know there is more question coming.
I just can't believe it. Like, yeah.
There's more
questions. Some days I'm like, we really get to live together. Live together with God forever. Like,
right.
Wow.
It's unbelievable. I think the love story of God, you sit back and you meditate and you're like, wow, like he is an incredible God. Left his throne, came down and he was abused by human being whom he created and just went through all these terrible things just so he can like draw us to himself. It's an incredible thing. He's most other belief system, they have to reach God. They have to do things to impress God. They have to, you know, try to get to God. But for us, God loved us so much that he came down to our level and he did everything possible to save us, including being humiliated by the human beings which he created. So it's just, once you understand that, it's mind blowing. All right. Let me see if there's any more questions. Let's round up. Thank you so much for joining us from all around the world. God bless you. God keep you. I hope you are encouraged. I hope you learn so much. As many on this line that are not saved, I pray the Lord will save you. So, Miss Catherine, please go ahead and pray for those online, and then we'll take you backstage. We'll announce the winner, and then we'll wrap up for today. Please pray for everyone on the line.
Okay. Thank you. As the gracious and heavenly Father, I just thank you for this day. Thank you for Joy's ministry. And I thank you for each and every one of the individuals that is viewing this ministry or will watch it later. I pray that you come into their lives, you bless them abundantly, you show them your face. And for those that don't know you, that you would reveal yourself to them in the individual way that they need and only you know. And I also pray for the family members of those watching, if they're struggling with drug addiction or other habitual sins, that you would show them that you have the power to set them free and help them to be obedient to you and to walk one day at a time, one step closer to you. And I just thank you again for Joy's ministry and this day and for giving us all life and breath. Amen.
Amen. One more thing before you leave, Miss Catherine. Somebody want to know, what are you doing now? What is going on in your life right now?
So I take care of my daughter. She's six. I have a relationship with my older kids. I have a relationship with my parents. I am working on starting a cleaning business, hopefully. And I currently work for a place called Children and Families of Iowa as a career planner. So I help people find jobs. And in my free time, I like to do what that picture shows, go out and evangelize. I like to evangelize and involved in the church. I help in the children's room and I go to various community groups, Bible studies, you know, when they're available.
Praise God. Praise God. Thank you so much, Ms. Catherine. Thank you for sharing with us. We're so grateful for your time. And I think it has been put in the comment section how people can see your full salvation testimony on YouTube and, you know, some of the other places it's located. So right now I'm going to take you backstage so I can talk to my viewers a little bit, announce the winner. Thank you so much. Everybody, please help me thank Ms. Catherine. God bless you. I see a whole bunch of comments now.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. Jesus saves. Yes, I see it in the comment. Thank you so much. All right, let me take you out. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, guys. Thank you for joining me today. God bless you. Let me set up. Who are the winners of who are the winners of our comment? So usually, whenever we're about to have a monthly salvation testimony, we'll put the poster out, and then we want you to go to the comment section and just basically repeat what was said on the poster, on the description, and then from there, randomly, we just pick a winner. So it's not like, hey, you have to do anything special. It's just all random. So quickly, let's announce the winners. If you see your name, your picture, just send a message to my inbox on Facebook and we will reply you with some good things. Yep. So here are our winners. I hope this thing is going to project very well. Here are the winners. God bless you, everyone. Thank you so much for sharing. Thank you so much for remaining. Okay, hold on. Let me make this so that everyone be able to see it. Uh-oh. All right. So this is our first winner. Can you see? Are you able to see his name? Okereke Ugoshuku. Can you see your picture? So send us a message, inbox us, and we will send you your winning prize. Okereke Ogeshiku, God bless you. Can you all please congratulate him? Our next winner is Victoria. What is it? Edimeka, I hope you can see your name very well. Please inbox us. Victoria, the next one is Precious. Precious, you see your picture. Inbox us, Precious. The next one, wow, it shows a lot. Keep Hope Alive. You see your picture, Keep Hope Alive. Send us a message for the prize, Keep Hope Alive. The next one, man, who's going to give out all this stuff? Faith Okoronkwo, Faith. Send us an inbox. I hope you can see your name very well. Faith Okoronkwo. Oh my goodness, I'm trying to. Okay, there you go. Faith. At least you recognize your own pictures, okay? All right, the next person is Matthew, you can recognize your picture. Okay, let me see. Matthew, the last name is Eyinanda Adebere. Matthew, hopefully you recognize your name. Can you see? Ugh, this stuff is blurry. I didn't know it was going to be blurry. So Matthew, hopefully you can see yourself. The next person is, okay, I think that's it. Matthew, Rume Grace. Can you see Rume Grace? Let's see. Rume Grace. Hopefully you can recognize your profile picture. Who else? I think that is all. Keep Hope Alive, Precious, Okereke, Victoria. And that is all. That is all, everyone. God bless you so much. Thank you so much for joining me this afternoon. I'm grateful. I'm glad that we heard Catherine's story. I pray the Lord will bless every one of you. The Lord will strengthen you in the faith. In Jesus' name. Don't forget next month. Join us next month. We're going to have our special guest from South Africa. She's going to come and share her wonderful salvation testimony. Also, don't forget to share this in different groups and pages and let people know the great work that Jesus is doing all around the world. Jesus saved. He's able to set free from sin. He's able to empower us to live the Christian life. So share this story so that other people will know that Jesus saved and they can come to Him, our true Savior. We don't want to be religious. We don't want to just be doing things that, you know, doesn't make any sense. When there is a Savior, His name is Jesus. Thank you, guys. God bless you. Thank you from Nigeria, from London, from UK, from Texas. We need your love. All right. Okay, everybody, I'm leaving now. I see you. Let's do our closing. And I'll be all the same.